That means that almost half of every disabled veteran coming home won't have a job. And granted, the Department of Defense is not a jobs program.
No, I understand.
And that's why it's, but it is so important for people to understand that this investment isn't just about the job. It's about capability.
Right.
It's about the capability to defend America. It's also about the capability to have a strong industrial base in this country so that we can respond to those threats. You know, just because we have budget problems right now doesn't mean the threats that our country faces are going to go away. Those threats will still be out there. And so, you know, when I was a young infantry platoon leader in Iraq, I didn't plan my missions based upon whether or not I had 3 Humvees or 10 Humvees. I based my mission upon what my commander told me I had to do. And then I went out there and found the equipment necessary to make it happen. And so, you know, it goes to show that the administration and some in Congress are looking at this somewhat backwards. They want to base our national security upon what we have as opposed to what threats we face. And we think that would be dangerous.
Our guest, Joel Ahrens, we're talking, of course, about the Coalition for Common Defense, and I want to give him an opportunity also to explain his organization, Veterans for a Strong America. But before I do that, real quickly, Joel, tell us what do you expect from these communities, military communities such as ours? And by the way, I see that you're taking this message ostensibly to basically the conservative element within Washington, D.C. Read that, the Tea Party, members and those that have a Tea Party affiliation, a conservative affiliation. What about the liberal affiliation? What about is this message being sent also to liberal members of Congress?
Well, we're taking our message to all 50 states. We're taking it to all members of Congress. Certainly, we're focused on speaking to those who are receptive. And here's what we're finding: we're actually finding that members of Congress who say that they're members of the Tea Party, they're with us. They have the military's back. You know, there may be a few part of the vocal minority of the Tea Party out there who doesn't want to spend money on anything. But what we're finding is the vast majority of the Tea Party actually wants to fulfill the constitutional mandate to provide for the common defense. And you know what? We're still finding some old-fashioned Democrats out there who want to do the same thing. And so we're gonna partner with folks. We're gonna partner with anybody, regardless of whether they're in the Republican Party, the Democrat Party, or the Tea Party. We still think that there are plenty of members of Congress out there who understand the threats we face, and they still want to invest in America.
All right, but we and North Carolina recently had the opportunity to make a contribution in the form of an outlying landing field, which was quite controversial. And I have been defending the Navy ever since their first attempt at doing so. I thought they were even-handed, and I thought they were forthright in their presentations. States such as North Carolina, where there is a significant investment, Fort Bragg, Seymour Johnson Air Force Base, Camp Lejeune, New River, Cherry Point, do the states themselves need to play a role in this, and can state legislators and governors possibly contribute?
Well, I think they absolutely can contribute to this, and what they can. One of the threats we face, if there are $1.2 trillion in cuts, is first of all, military infrastructure projects, which employ local contractors and local construction workers. Those projects, there's 150 projects out there that are determined to be built in 2013. Those projects will be on hold. That means there's 150 projects nationwide where contractors and construction workers and electrical workers and all the people who build infrastructure will not be employed as a result of this. And also, one of the other problems that we face, and I think you brought it up, is that we probably face another round of the base realignment and closure system again. If we do not have the resources to invest in that infrastructure, we're going to have to shut down bases. We're going to have to consolidate. And really the key question here for a lot of folks, you know, whether you're worried about the local economy, you're worried about your Marine, you're worried about the community, Americans have to ask themselves a simple question. Do I want an America that is no longer a superpower in the world?
Mm-hmm.
Do I want to live in a country that gets turned into a regional power mm-hmm. and no longer has the kind of superpower status that maintains the kind of economy we've had in the past?
All right, I've got to challenge you on one quick item, and again, I thank you for your time. Joel Ahrens, Veterans for a Strong America. Obviously, the expense of maintaining a military is significant, and in fact, arguably is what brought the Soviet Union down. We do have to balance some of our issues. Is there an understanding that maybe there should be compromise within the budget, or is this an issue of keeping hands off on the defense budget?
You know, I think Americans have made it crystal clear over the last 18 months that all spending, defense spending, domestic spending, entitlement reform, all spending needs to be put on the table. And defense spending was put on the table. And over the course of this last year, it was determined that $469 billion of defense spending was going to be cut. And while that $469 billion in cuts is going to be difficult, it is going to be detrimental to some of our missions. We're at a point now where we need to decide whether or not adding or piling more cuts mm-hmm. on top of the $469 billion is responsible. And I would offer that cutting the military's budget even further is irresponsible. You know, we have some hard questions to ask in this country, and one of the things we need to understand is that 57% of the entire budget, the entire federal budget, is spent on mandatory entitlement spending.
Right, right. I wanted to hear that. So basically you're saying, yes, there is an understanding. It's just that when you get right down to it, we've got to set priorities.
We do. You know, the defense budget is only 19% of the American budget,
right.
But under this $1.2 trillion in cuts, it would suffer the vast majority proportionally of the cuts.
Mm-hmm.
And, again, fulfilling that constitutional mandate of providing for the common defense becomes very difficult to achieve with that kind of budget situation.
Our guest, Joel Ahrens. And, Joel, I've got to give you an opportunity to tell us about Veterans for a Strong America, one of many organizations associated with the Coalition for Common Defense. I will ask you in a moment what's the next step in the coalition. But first, tell us a little something about Veterans for a Strong America.
Veterans for a Strong America is an organization comprised of veterans of all different wars, peacetime and or combat, and what they are is all different political parties who have come together to say that we do need to set priorities, we do need to understand that there will be hard decisions made in America, but one of the things we need to do is we need to provide for our veterans, we need to provide for that common defense.
Mm-hmm.
If folks want to find out more, they can go to veteransforastrongamerica.org. And they'll find out we're a grassroots organization of veterans and veteran supporters who are mobilizing and communicating with members of Congress and the White House to ensure that our voices are heard.
An important issue, and of course we have a lot of veterans in our community and a lot of wounded warriors, wounded veterans, and that's something we've got to be cognizant of. Joel, as we wrap things up, final question for you. What next, and what's on tap? Are there more meetings, and you're going to be visiting states? What will be happening?
Well, we're going to be aggressively lobbying members of Congress. We're not aware of the situation yet. We're going to be ensuring that members of the 12 members of the super committee, we're going to be vigorously communicating with them. We're going to be mobilizing veterans in states around the country to contact not only their congressmen, but these 12 members. And I think what's next for your listeners out there is call your member of Congress today.
Okay.
Tell him that $1.2 trillion in cuts to the defense budget is simply unacceptable.
In fact, I spoke with him about this yesterday, in unknowing of the coalition's existence. And in fact, he's his concern is making sure that we can afford this. And of course, Walter Jones, a noted, renowned critic of both Operation Iraqi Freedom and Enduring Freedom, says, "Let's bring our troops home. Let's reinvest in our and reset our military so that we are prepared for any major event yet to occur." Joel, as always, thank you very much for taking the time to be with us. An important story, and we will be following this with great interest. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Our pleasure. Joel Ahrens, again, he is he's chairman and founder of Veterans for a Strong America, but also a member of the Coalition for Common Defense.